Regarding discourse, public discourse, the embassy had some posts talking about history, so the relations between Russia and Romania, historical
Objection,
relations.
sir. We had a post on, if you are speaking about the reception of, by the royal family for diplomatic corps, we had a post on current policy when our current policy has been completely presented very in a very biased way, not to say without any grounds, blaming Russia to be a major threat to everything. I'm summarizing. So I can, and I am ready to speak about it. What else you found there about history, please?
No, it's just that the Ministry of Foreign Affairs
I
said.
don't care. I've told you, we have good diplomatic principle to agree to disagree.
Yes.
This is exactly the case. I can't say to you that I can tell your foreign ministry what to publicize, what to declare in their press communications. It is their business. I am telling you what I can tell.
Ministry said the views are unacceptable, and it's not the first time that they said
We
that.
have agreed to disagree. And it is exactly the case. This is my comment.
I understand.
Please.
But in this context, how are the relations between the embassy and the ministry?
They are normal if we take into consideration the general state of our relations. Normal and natural.
They saying that the views are unacceptable.
They claim that there's some views which were expressed in a comment for the press of the embassy as an exercise of democratic right for freedom of expression and opinion, according to those European democratic values that Romania has been soliciting through its recent rotational presidency, and so on and so forth. What have you to say, to tell me about it, answering my position? If your foreign ministry believes like it wrote, it has its right. We have our right to present the current policy, I underscore, the current policy of our state in a proper perspective, in a realistic optics. If you want to dig deeper into those claims made in that purely protocol devoted to New Year and Christmas celebrations reception, believe me, I can't, maybe with the exception of American ambassador, because I hadn't had any chance of speaking to him at length, no colleague of mine was not shocked and hasn't expressed his solidarity with me, because it was just a great surprise for everybody that such a speech took place on such occasion. I don't want to continue because there is nothing personal on it, you see? And all other claims, if you want to discuss in detail, substantially, what it is all about, I'm ready, because I know very well what was written in our comment. Our comment, not a speech of a respectful and authoritative structure, though it is institution, better to say.
It is a response from the embassy, which is a public institution from the Russian government.
Public institution, it is opinion of your foreign ministry. In
Yes,
fact,
sir.
it is NGO, an NGO. But it was evidently, you see, it was evidently a biased, ungrounded attack on our foreign policy. It is duty and right, by the way, provided in diplomatic conventions of embassy to present official stand of its government on this regard. We stopped short of that. We didn't make any formal declarations. We didn't make any protests. We just wrote a comment explaining point by point that it is not true what was said and addressed to our country. It is our solemn duty as a diplomatic mission. What for do you believe diplomatic missions exist at all? You see? to be a channel of presenting governmental and public position of its own country. Believe me, if such an elementary function for diplomatic missions is denied, it is a new word. We have already run passed across this issue, a new word in diplomatic protocol and diplomatic practices. Though we see that something changes, but what about democratic value of freedom of expression of opinion?
But do you agree there is a limit between freedom of expression and presenting all the facts? Because let's say in December there was the accusation from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs that another post...
Once more you use this non-diplomatic term. I haven't heard anything about it from my colleagues in the Foreign Ministry.
It is.
I don't accuse anybody. I just explain.
No. It is just a press release, a statement by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs from December that said about a post.
There was an open letter we published in Evenimental Zile, I believe. You can find it. Our position, well argumented position, is sophisticatedly in detail is explained in that open letter. It was in mid-January, after vacations, because we have a specific calendar. Immediately after the new year, we have 8 days of vacation. This is one of the, to my mind, not worst achievements of democratic Russia after the Soviet Union. At that time, there were only 2 days. Now it is 8 days, including Orthodox Christmas by old Russian style.
Yes. The embassy stated then that there was a defamation campaign against the historical Red Army. And the ministry said that the information presented by the embassy was incomplete.
Well, they are free to complete it if they want. Nobody prevents them from doing it. But our stand, I repeat, there was a rather big open letter on behalf of the embassy. It was printed in Evenimental Zile. You can find it. I believe it is... available at our site as well, yes?
The EU has a project, I don't know if you're familiar with it, EU versus Disinfo, have you heard of it?
I see.
Yes,
okay,
yes.
Go on.
According to this project's website, its objective, I quote, is to increase public awareness and understanding of Kremlin's disinformation operations and to help citizens in Europe and beyond develop
it
resistance.
It is a prayer.
It is what it says, yes.
I see, I'm joking, of course. Yes. I'm teasing. Excuse me, please. What I can tell you, I've told you that I am a rather old person. And unfortunately, I have studied history thoroughly. After the First World War, in the Weimar Republic in Germany, which was a heir of old empire, of Hohenzollerns, yeah. There was an anecdote. For all our problems and troubles are to blame Jews and bicyclists. They appeared immediately a question, and why the bicyclists? The answer was, and why the Jews? It looks very distant from our modern reality, but I will easily and quickly show you that there is great commonality. Not to forget, what came out of that? Totalitarian imposition at first on the German society and then on the whole Western Europe. To prove it, I can tell you that on the 22nd of June 1941, the whole Western Europe, including Romania, being under domination, occupied, or just being represented by the Nazi, fascist, totalitarian regimes, attacked Soviet Union. And the starting point was that in the middle was Holocaust, or maybe even afterwards as well. Now, when we listen to this strategic communication, hybrid war, and so on, I remember, I'm sorry, the Minister of Propaganda of Hitler's government, his name was Goebbels. He said that the bigger is lie, and more often you repeat it, sooner great mass will believe it. So, coming now, just change in that anecdote two notions. Change Russia and Russians for Jews, or Jews for Russia and Russians, and cyclists for electric scooters, scooterists who are now riding across the streets of Bucharest and Patika. The continuation will be the same, you see? It is, to our mind, it is ridiculous. Ridiculous. I insist, ridiculous to claim that Russia is behind every problem that occurs in the European Union. Even Soviet Union was not blamed for it, in spite of the fact that Soviet Union, there was a period of time when communist camp was from Berlin to Beijing. And later it remained large enough. It was clear. Communism, it proclaimed destruction of capitalism, it was not good, yes, very nice. Why not communist? We're a regular capitalist country. If you, believe me, if you make comparison between freedom of speech, opinion, and pluralism of opinion in Russia and in Romania, believe me, we'll gain a match immediately, because we have open opposition mouthpieces, radio stations, TV channels, which are preaching, I don't know, preaching the dollar notes, one after another, just looking at them and making prayers, and so on and so forth. Have we anything similar here or in Europe? Unfortunately, alternative point of view now is immediately blamed as useful idiotism to benefit Russia under the influence of Kremlin and so on and so forth. Alternative point of view. This is a trend. I hope that this trend will be received by European civil society adequately and will be opposed. But this is the trend towards totalitarianism. That very totalitarian trend that played very bad joke with the whole mankind after the First World War. Doing the difference even is more awful. I have already mentioned to you what world we have now. We can't play with fire. We can't afford it if we want to live on this planet. What for? Tell me, please, how many TV channels broadcasting, by the way, officially broadcasting in Russian Federation, licensed by our Ministry for Telecommunications and so on, from Europe exist? How many? France Inter, Deutsche Welle, God knows whom, everybody. And they are playing, BBC, of course, and others. And they are playing this one and the same tune. Russia is our threat. Recently, a beautiful example. When former Chechen terrorist, bearing a Georgian name, a terrorist who is against whom a warrant is issued by our Attorney General office, who was he is established as responsible for killing dozens of people personally during the Chechen War. He was killed, murdered in Berlin. What was the publication of the Times? Well respected. For ages, one of the first British newspapers, historically. Mouthpiece of democracy. What was it? Russian dissident was murdered in Berlin. Isn't it another proof that Russia is a threat to the European security? What is it? Tell me. Is it Goebbels' propaganda, Goebbels-style propaganda? Or is it what? And against that, BBC is, by the way, publicly financed agency. If maybe CNN is not, maybe. But, for example, such Franz von Katter, as far as I know, as well, has governmental finance sources supporting them. But the only channel established by Russia, RT, is gradually pushed away out of all possibilities to be disseminated in the Western Europe, fined for speaking about neo-Nazi revival in Ukraine, they are fined for not allowing alternative opinion to be expressed. Alternative opinion about what? About necessity of revival of neo-Nazism in Ukraine. This alternative opinion British authorities are defending. So I am alarmed, as an old person, I am alarmed that without any ideological basis, like it was during the classical Cold War, when communist camp was opposing capitalist camp, they were not just controversy, it was antagonism. Communist theoreticians, starting from Karl Marx, they declared that communism is going to achieve final victory over capitalism, capitalism should be destroyed. It proved to be maybe not very good in many cases, though you can't say that communism has disappeared from the map, looking at the people of China.
One other event that maybe you are familiar with is Russia being banned, Russian athletes being banned to participate in major sport events due to doping. How did Russia receive this news?
Russia received it with great dissatisfaction, to put it diplomatically, because it is completely unfair, unjust, not to say politicized, it is the most political correct word that you could find. At least for two reasons. The things are going to unroll, there will be appeals in the, it is called Court of Appeal, Court d'Appellation Sportive, CAS, and so on and so forth. For two reasons at least. It is collective punishment, which is very characteristic of totalitarian, in particular Nazi regimes and fascist regimes, collective punishment, and double punishment on one and the same allegedly committed crime. And even there is a third type. It is collective punishment of innocent people. Because now we hear voices that all Russian athletes, they should be banned from everywhere and forever. Why? Have they been caught? Dozens, hundreds of sportsmen, they have nothing to do with it. But some quarters, international allegedly anti-doping quarters, which has no representation of Russia at all, which is dominated by American and Canadian and British officials, paid including from the money of Russian donation into that world, they claim that Russia is a demonic state. That if something happened, it was evidently some overwhelming, I don't know what, conspiracy, I don't know, and so on and so forth. It is racist approach. If something of this kind would have been said in American domestic politics, you know, anybody would immediately destroy it as white sexist, I don't know, racist, I don't know, WASP and so on and so forth, immediately. But in the world of sport, which has been created by Louis de Coubertin and others as a major, if you like, what is it, sphere when, where all those animosities and maybe some misunderstandings between nations would find their way out peacefully, in peaceful, fair competition with them. If you go to tell me that Russians are using doping, they are using doping not more than the Westerners. And even less. If you take, for example, biathlon and ski teams of Norway and some other, they are asthmatics. They are suffering from asthma. You know it? They are bringing hundreds of doses of anti-asthmatic medicine to the Olympic Games. Hundreds or even thousands. Beautiful American Olympic gymnastics champion from Rio Olympics, a new one, an African-American girl resembling both Serena and Venus Williams in tennis. She is suffering from mental disease. She is openly using narcotics and other banned doping medicine. Why? Because she has a therapeutic permission. My dear friend, if we deal with sport in this way, We can only state that sport has become a victim of Western pharmaceutical giants. There was Meldonium story. It is almost a placebo. The same medicine produced by the Western pharmaceutical companies, but being 10 times more expensive. It is okay. It is used widely. And that Meldonium, by the way, created by a researcher, scientist in modern Latvia, and he still lives there, is banned. And dozens of people quite unaware that it is great doping had been caught, disqualified, including Maria Sharapova, who was so absent-minded, so concentrated on training that ignoring some email which had been sent to her. Absent-minded girl, you can imagine it. But she was cruelly, completely mercilessly, she was disqualified for 18 months or something like that. So, and you tell me that there could be any other reaction in Russia? I'm sorry. The recent story of alleged database, where is the original database? Show it to us. No. Some of our athletes tried to sue them in courts, in regular criminal courts. They adopted in, I don't remember in what Canadian provinces they are located, Ontario or nearby. They adopted a local regional legislation that they are not, that they are immune from any legal persecution. Those guys who accused and punished innocent sportsmen, there are numbers of them. They have their human rights. They are deprived of the human rights on the only basis. They are Russian. What is it? It is racism. Politically oriented racism. This is the only explanation, politically correct explanation. In fact, it is, of course, politics, pure politics. And what about numerous declarations that sport should stay beyond politics, out of politics? Politics should be kept out of sport. What is their value now? It is for International Olympic Committee to say its word, how it cares about integrity of international Olympic movement. There is no single accusation, as you use it, about Russian Olympic Committee. It has changed all the leadership. It has only prominent and clean sportsmen, veterans in its composition, and so on and so forth. But we are told, no Olympic team, no Olympic committee. It is against Olympic charter. So who is ruling the sports? American pharmaceuticals, acting through handful of officials from America, Canada, and Britain, imposing their politicized will on the whole international sporting community, or whom? This is our reaction. Otherwise, as far as I know, similar problems Romania is facing, but it is not my job to intervene into that topic. That is why, my dear friend, from my youth I was an amateur sportsman, tried to exercise first of all in cross-country skiing. Believe me, it is very hard job to run 15 kilometers, for example. Though it is a sprinter, 10, 15 kilometers now for males, it is sprinter distance. Once I've run 30 kilometers, almost a marathon, but on the skis. And I came to a conclusion that stop, it is too much for me. I'll stay in the ranks, in the mass of amateurs. Never I'll go into any professional sport.
So do you think this is something general?
I know it. And I know that if you are asthmatic and you are running faster than healthy people, it is a trick. And we know the mechanism of the trick, and everybody is silent. Why? Why don't they disqualify Norway once and forever, at least for 10 years? You remember the story of, it was Neil Armstrong, I believe, famous American cyclist,
yes,
who after about a dozen of victories of Tour de France, confessed that he used doping all the way. It is all the same, whether it's propaganda, whether it's global stability. If you go on like that, then you shouldn't expect that everything is going to go smoothly. It is opening the way to a crisis. It is opening a way to a conflict. Thanks God that sports is not so dangerous like the arms race. And the Olympic movement was exactly, I've told you, was exactly created to become an arena of peaceful competition.
But it cannot be racially motivated to...
It is racially motivated. I insist on it. Because Russian athletes are punished on the basis that they are Russians.
But race is, let's say, to the race, to the color of the skin, let's say,
really?
Simply.
Really? But we are all whites, majorly. So, what you like ideological? There is no ideological controversies between us. We are not communists. We are preaching the same liberal values like you and suffering from it. Because we are looking at people's China and watching their overwhelming achievements without abandoning major, if you like, values and major laws of their development within the framework of the communist regime. Coming back to your question, we have nothing against anything that is voluntary exercised by European Union and its eventual partners. If it is a free will of them, it is their business. We are looking for stable, predictable relationship, strategic relationship with the European Union, because it is our neighbor and one of the greatest commercial trade partners. As for NATO, it is quite different. We don't see any need in expansion of NATO, because NATO lost its rationale, its raison d'etre, at least 30 years ago, with the fall of the Berlin Wall, or maybe in a year, with the dismantling of the Warsaw Pact. And evidently, with dismantlement of the Soviet Union and abandonment of communist doctrine, it is written in our constitution.